Welcome to Shadow of Truth with your host, Dave Kranzler from InvestmentResearchDynamics.com and Rory Hall from TheDailyCoin.org. And we have our returning guest who is rapidly becoming our eyes and ears in Beijing, Mr. Jeff Brown from 44days.net. And he is also the author of the book, 44 Days. Jeff, how are you doing today?
Doing great. Good morning and good evening to you all. We're, again, 14 hours ahead of you all, so great to hear from you guys.
Dave, how's it going over on your end?
It's going great here. We've had 2 days in a row in Denver where it doesn't feel like we're living in Seattle, Washington. Sunshine and mountains, which is what Colorado's known for.
And you can actually see them, I presume.
That's exactly right. I might even get to play some tennis outside today.
Dave, wow. You and I were talking earlier today about the lack of information, in particular on silver, that comes out of China and all of the regulations that China has in place regarding the importation and, more specifically, the exportation of silver, and how these guys kind of have everything under lock and key, and you can't get it in and you can't get it out without somebody knowing about it and knowing where it came from and where it's going to. And does that about sum it up?
Yeah, that sums it up. What I would just like to add to that is it's kind of incredible the degree to which misinformation and disinformation is propagated and promoted out there, especially by Wall Street banks and Bay Street banks, and I guess it's Long Wharf banks, whatever the big financial district is called in London these days.
The city.
A lot of banks issue research reports on how much gold is going into China, and the only thing they reference is World Gold Council numbers, and the only numbers the World Gold Council references is numbers that are published through official sources about gold going into China through Hong Kong. Well, as it turns out, as Jeff well knows, Shanghai and Beijing are also now significant ports of entree for gold and silver. By design, the Chinese government does not publish those statistics. So what's incredible is that we really don't know very much about how much gold is being imported into China in total every month. And we know nothing about how much silver is going into China. And one thing that I dug up a couple of years ago, and I published it on my blog at one point, there's available something called the Law of the People's Republic of China, and there's a specific section on regulations on the control of gold and silver. And if you read through that, essentially, other than gold and silver items that have been approved by the government for leaving the country, nothing in terms of real gold and silver ever leaves China, and that's by government decree. I thought it would be interesting to hear what Jeff had to say and what he dug up on China's silver market, because most of us who analyze this really don't, there's not a lot of information available on the Chinese silver market.
Yeah, and that's true both in English and Chinese. I scoured the Chinese internet in Chinese. I think there is less known about the silver bullion quantities in China than there are even gold. I could find nothing. I did try to contact the National Bureau of Statistics and never got any response from them. And the fact that I could not find any statistics on silver suggests that it is also top secret. So I think we can, you know, we're 99% sure that silver bullion imports and exports are like gold, you know, a state secret in China. For the listeners out there, the harmonization system tariff code, the HS code, which is what all the customs bureaus use around the world to harmonize, you know, the statistics on imports and exports. For silver bullion, it's 7106. 7106, and I think every country goes further down 7106.92. And then for China, it's 7106.9290. So if anybody can find any information about silver, you know, please let me know. But I came up, I drew a blank.
Well, in the this email that you had sent to Dave and I a couple of weeks ago, you were talking about the silver ore extraction rates.
Yeah.
As far as, and you were able to dig up some information about that. And I presume that this is the, and it looks like this was imported silver ore into China. And if you can, just speak to that just a little bit.
Yeah, I found a PowerPoint presentation, cost me 20 RMB. And anyway, I was actually able to find this PowerPoint presentation, and from it shows silver ore and concentrates, and that is the HS code 2616. And basically, they were zero until 2012, and then in 2013, they really spiked up. And then I was able to find 2 months in 2014 that shows that imports of silver ore and concentrates is still pretty pretty substantial. In 2013, they imported 332,000 tons of silver ore and concentrates in 2013. And then based on the 2 months of information I found from you, for you guys, the, it extrapolates out to about 240,000-250,000 tons for 2014.
Okay. Yeah. 240,000 metric tons is what,
For exactly,
2014
yeah.
is what you've got. And give that number for 2013 again.
332,000, just rounded up, 332,000 metric tons.
332,000. So that's roughly 30,000 tons a month. Not quite, but pretty close.
Yeah.
29,000 tons of ore a month. And is it about 8 ounces of silver per metric ton?
That's what I found that table I sent you all, that it has dropped from 13 ounces per ton of extraction refining rate in 2005 down to 8. I don't know what you and Dave think about that. That's really a substantial drop, and I'm not enough of a mining engineer to know why. But even at 8 ounces per metric ton, that shows that in 2013, ore imports would be about 75 metric tons of silver bullion. It's not a huge, huge sum, but at that 2616 HST code for the ore also does include concentrates. So it could be, you know, maybe it's even, we could maybe double it, you know, to, you know, 150 metric tons, but it's still not a huge sum of silver. You know, based on everything I've found, it looks like they're trying to get their hands on all the silver they can get.
Well, considering that they're the number three mining country, silver miner behind Mexico and Peru, which means, I mean, according to what you've sent us, is that they're mining about 3,200 metric tons a year of bullion.
Exactly. Yeah, so, bullion,
So that's just kind of sounds like gravy to me.
Yeah, you know, absolutely.
We'll just take everything that we can get our hands on. We're digging up everything that we can at home, and whatever you got laying around over at your house, we'll take that as well.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
Jeff,
Dave.
Just for clarification for the listeners, and I might have missed this, where are you sourcing these import numbers from again? What is the HST code? What does HST stand for?
Oh, HS is the Harmonization System Tariff Code. I think it's probably went back to GATT and the World Trade Organization. All the countries sat down and developed this code system so that when, you know, China exports, you know, this widget, it has a specific custom code that they log so that you can go and get the statistics on that widget. So for whether it's sand or gold or automobiles or rubber or silk or whatever, every there's thousands and thousands of these codes, and for silver bullion it's 7106, and that's true for every country in the world. And then for silver ore and silver concentrates, it is 2616. So that in theory, you should be able to go to any country's statistics bureau and find out what they have exported and imported under that particular code. The problem in China is that for gold and silver, those HST codes don't exist.
Okay. So where did you dig this information up from?
Just getting on the Chinese internet and typing in Chinese, you know, just, you know, silver bullion. And I kept finding, you know, ore and concentrates, but I could not find anything on silver. I mean, the silver bullion was just a black hole.
Either they're keeping their importation of silver bullion completely in the dark, or
that's for sure.
Or the only thing available for them to import would be the concentrates. And just to circle back really quickly to the decline in the amount of silver per metric ton of ore concentrate, most likely the reason for that is what's known as high grading. And ever since the price of gold and silver have been hammered down by the manipulators, there hasn't been much in the way of exploration. And what big mining companies have been doing is they've been doing what's known as high grading their mines. They've been taking the lowest hanging fruit out as quickly as they can and selling it in order to raise cash. So my guess is that the drop in the amount of silver per metric ton of ore concentrate has to do with the fact that China was originally getting higher grade ore, you know, in the early part of the sequence of numbers that you found for this. I think you said, what, 2012 or 2011?
Yeah, actually 2013.
Okay, yeah. And so going forward, you know, since then they've been getting lower grade ore because that's what's being pulled out of the mines now.
Okay.
So that's just a guess, but I think it's a pretty well-educated guess. But it also tells you, you know, if China's willing to pay for and import lower grade ore and silver concentrates, it means they're trying to get a hold of as much silver as they can any way possible.
And that's about a 40-50% drop.
From 13 to 8.
Yes.
Well, when you think about it, if they're sitting on $1.2 trillion in U.S. dollar foreign reserves and they're trying to convert those dollars into hard assets, I don't think they care if they're importing ore and concentrate that has 12 ounces of silver per metric ton or 8 ounces of silver per metric ton. The key there is they're converting their Federal Reserve funny money into real money.
Hard assets. Yeah.
Yes. And you made an interesting note in this information that you had sent to Dave and I, and I think that it ties in quite well with everything that we're seeing going on, in particular with the Chinese and some of the moves that they've been making over the past 5 or 6 years. And you reference the Chinese century of shame and the Western colonist who stole, and this number really kind of took me aback, to be perfectly honest, 40,625 metric tons of silver were stolen by the Western banking cabals from the Chinese, or almost 4,000 metric tons per year, while addicting the people to 281,250 metric tons of opium, 7 metric tons of opium for 1 metric ton of silver bullion. I don't think that they're going to soon forget that.
No, absolutely not. And the British American opium trade, the Americans grew their opium in Turkey. The British grew their opium in India. And then they, you know, through the opium wars in the 1840s and 1850s, That was the nadir for the Chinese in terms of their of their political and military power. And let's face it, you know, the Western colonialism was ascendant at that time. And they what they would do is they would force a treaty onto China and say, okay, you have caused us, you know, you have caused us economic loss, and so you have to pay us penalties. And so the penalties were silver bullion. And so they actually had to sign treaties where they had to pay in silver bullion not only penalties but for the opium. And then the opium was shipped. Then it was finally technically illegal to ship to China. But then, of course, you know, you can always find, you know, third party cooperators. And so then the Americans and the British found Chinese and other Asian, you know, what the Chinese would call compradors, who actually imported it in. But the whole point is that the Western colonialists got about 25% of the Chinese population addicted to opium, about 100 million people from the 1840s up until Mao came into power in 49, and he and the communists expunged it in 2 years, which is an amazing feat. Literally wiped it out in 2 years.
So you're talking about 1949, right?
Yeah, 1949, and that's why the American and British opium trade into China has been called the longest-running and largest global criminal empire in the history of humanity, and it really is true. It's a crime against humanity. It's a crime against decency. It's a crime, but you know that's what Western colonialists do. You know, it's all about money. And opium was so incredibly profitable. And, you know, you see 7 metric tons of opium for 1 ton of silver. So you can just imagine, you know, the profits involved.
That's incredible.
Well, I think that it basically, the way I would sum it up is that it was a way for the British and the U.S. elitists, or if you want to call them colonialists, to shove opium down the throats of the Chinese and force them to cough up silver in exchange.
And of course, it weakened the country and debased the economy. I mean, you know, it became a drug based economy. Yeah. And you know, even after they were finally in the early 1900s, that they were actually able to get the Western colonialists to stop importing opium, and actually they were pretty much forced out of it because the Chinese started growing it. And so then I did the calculations on that, and the amount of land that was devoted to opium production was costing the Chinese about 4 million metric tons a year in rice and corn production. So there were increasing starvation. And then Westerners just moved up the food chain. Instead of opium, they started importing morphine. So it's sordid, it's demented, it's twisted, it's sick. And so into the 1930s and 1940s, they just replaced opium with morphine, and we're getting the Chinese all addicted on morphine, which is, you know, even more profitable, just like heroin is even more profitable than morphine. So it's staggering to think that this was, you know, that this went on for 110 years.
And the other part of it is that they managed to loot from the Chinese populace 40,625 metric tons of silver.
Yeah, bullion.
Yes, of bullion, which is that's an enormous amount of silver.
Yeah, I think somebody can run the numbers. I think it's something like $22 billion or something like that in today's dollars. But of course, back then, the magnitude of that was even greater. You know, given the exchange rates and the size of the economies, it was even greater than that.
And that actually was probably the main thrust of destabilizing the entire Chinese economy, dethroning them from the world superpower that they were at that time, because they were at that time the great economic engine of the world.
Or am I wrong? Yeah. No, they were. They were the number one world economy until 1872. What was even more amazing is after the Civil War in 1865, after that was over, and that slave trade in the United States ended. Again, slavery is a very, very profitable business model. So the Americans from 1865 until 1874 just changed their location of where they bought their slaves, and they came over to China, and that's where you hear about all the coolies. Well, all those coolies that were in the United States, you know, building railroads and working Latin America in the sugarcane fields, et cetera, they were Chinese slaves. And so the United States was still going after the slave market all the way up to 1874, and it's estimated that they stole up to a million Chinese to export all over North America and Latin America, and of course almost none of them came home. So the Americans extended every ship that went to China to buy the coolies or to steal the coolies, they were American flagships, and that went on until 1874, until the Americans were finally shamed into stopping it.
It's really just another example of Americans doing what Americans do best. You go into a country and you plunder it, and the guys who do the plundering reap all the riches, and then you move on. And it's what we're trying to do in Ukraine right now, and Russia is basically drawing a line in the sand.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Man. Well, gentlemen, where should we go from here? We've looked at the ore production, what we can, and we've looked at how the history once again ties into where we stand today.
Well, why don't we talk?
I'd like to just point out here is that Jeff, you've done a phenomenal job unearthing information about Chinese silver imports, because I know at least, and I do a lot of reading in this sector, and I've never come across any of this information. I'm not saying it's not out there, but I've never come across this information about Chinese ore concentrate imports in any of the sort of the, I don't want to call it mainstream, but in almost all of the alternative media commentary and analysis that's done on the Chinese gold and silver market. I've never seen these numbers. This is phenomenal.
Well, don't waste your time learning Chinese. Just ask me the questions, and I'll type the Chinese into the Chinese internet and look in. You don't want to. Chinese is too hard to learn.
Well, and I want to echo what Dave was saying as far as I appreciate all of your efforts and everything that you've done, and we're only scratching the surface here, folks. So you know. We've got a lot more information coming regarding the Chinese gold and silver, as far as their ore concentrates, as far as their what they're mining, what their bullion stock looks like, who's moving it around, and where it's coming from, and where it's going to. And next up is going to be we're going to take a look at the solar industry through the eyes of China. And Jeff has already done just a stellar job of digging up some great information. And we'll be bringing that to you in about a week or week, 10 days, 2 weeks from now. And we'll have that all laid out for you. And it's going to be a show that's dedicated just to Chinese solar power and solar panels and solar production. So be looking for that.
And it takes silver to make them.
And it takes silver to make every bit of it. So that's the whole point. But is there anything else, gentlemen, that we should leave our audience with today?
No, thank you very much. And y'all have a wonderful week. And we'll hit solar next time. And then after that, we'll do gold. I know all about how to buy gold now in China, and it's been a lot of fun. In fact, I may even buy some by the time we have our show on gold.
I've seen those pictures you sent us, Jeff, and I it'll be fun to share those with the audience because they're phenomenal. You've done a great job.
Yes. And certainly appreciate it. And we'll talk with you again real soon, Jeff.
All right. Bye-bye, guys.